how. This session, we're going to be focusing on contemplative practices, doing contemplative meditation, which in my mind is really, as I've said previously, the crown jewel of all of this. But before we get into that, let's just check in and see if there are any questions from earlier today. So if you have a question, please just say yes, and then I'll wait for you to type it in. If you do not have a question, simply say no, and then I'll be aware of who's thinking about what. Okay, good. So we've got a couple questions. And be advised that tomorrow's sessions, that these are focused specifically on Q&A. So this essentially is ask anything you want about what we've gone over this weekend, or about meditation practice, or anything related to your meditation practice. And if I can respond in a semi-intelligent way, I'll do my best. And if I don't know the answer, well then, we'll just pass on it and do some research on our own. But tomorrow's sessions, we're going to be doing meditations together to really tie in what we've been learning. But also the focus will be on answering any other kinds of questions that you have about this whole process. So in the meantime, we've got three people with questions, and I'll just wait for them to type them in and send them over. And those of you who do have the Kriya Yoga Vichara book, to get a little more insights into the contemplative process, we do have a chapter specifically on it. Chapter 8, page 148. And yes, the very first sentence within that chapter, I say again, the crown jewel of Kriya Yoga Vichara is the capacity to know and to be. So you can tell I think pretty highly of this, and you'll see why as we get into our time together. Okay. All right, so good point. So Anna's statement, she says, during the chanting through the chakras, it can be quite tiring. Is it okay to shorten the chanting time per chakra? Yes, it's fine to shorten it per chakra, but it's tiring because you're not used to doing it. It's the same way with meditation. It's the same way with pranayama. For some people, they can't do a lot of pranayama because it's tiring, and even meditation in general. So what you want to do is figure out for yourself what is a good amount of time to be chanting in each chakra. But you have to start exploring how can you get into it without it being tiring, because it's not really a tiring thing. I mean, if you think about how crazy your mind goes, you know, you would think that would be more tiring than just simply focusing on a point and saying om, 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 om. So you have to be cautious of situations in your meditation where you experience resistance, because that is a type of resistance to be tired. And realize that since chanting through the chakras is so important, and the reason it's so important is because it's enlivening that life force, the prana within the body, just like we talked about in the Bhagavad Gita. By enlivening that life force, that's enlivening the energies that are supportive of your practice. And you have to remember there's the other side, which is very resistant to that support. So it can come up as lethargy. So I don't want you to strain yourself by really trying to get in there and do the chain through the chakras. But you do got to be aware that over time, it should be such that you can just do it naturally and easy and comfortably, and it's not tiring. So usually the indication of being tired is an indication of a subtle resistance. And that just shows that resistance isn't always just an obvious thing. It can be something like, oh, I'm tired, right? So keep that in mind. So during meditation, if I feel lightheaded, do I just go back to breath meditation and come back and join you? Or do you have other suggestions, especially chanting through the chakras? As soon as you start to feel like lightheaded, we'll just let it go and focus on the breath. Just feel the breath. And then when you feel ready again, come back to the guided meditation or your mantra. And remember, this is no different than any other kind of training. So when I would work with people doing kettlebell exercises, which is a vigorous weight training exercise, not everyone could do the same amount. So we would have it set up to where we'd say, all right, we're going to do 25 swings. And if they could do 25 swings, great. But if they couldn't, they would do as many as they could. They would catch their breath, and then they would come back around and join again. So yeah, you want to treat it the same way. Do as much as you can, and don't be afraid to kind of push yourself a little bit every now and then, just to kind of overcome a hump or an obstacle. But you always come back to it. So it's a good point. Do you think it takes 10,000 hours for success? I know that's I forget what book that is. What is that? Think and Grow Rich or something like that. And I think it takes a lot of hours for success. I don't think that you can tally it up to 10,000 and say that's it, because you know there are plenty of people I know who've been meditating for a long time, way over 10,000 hours, and they're still as confused as they were, you know, many, many years ago. So it's not 10,000 hours of just doing something. It's doing something well. Okay. And, you know, the descriptions I always give is, if I'm trying to learn to play the guitar and I decide I want to watch a TV show and have a conversation with my best friend while I'm trying to learn something, I'm not going to be doing that very well, even though my fingers are moving and it looks like I'm doing something. But if I just spend 5 minutes really focusing on what's going on, I'll learn much quicker than an hour of just not paying too much attention. So don't worry about 10,000 hours. It's going to be different for everybody, but the real focus needs to be on the quality of the activity, the specific attention you give to it. Yeah, 10,000 hours. He figured it out. 10,000 hours is 8 hours every day for 3.5 years. Well, hey, that's worth it, right? Just go to work, sleep, and meditate. If you do that, it's 24 hours in a day. It's perfect. So maybe sleep 7.5 hours. That way you have some time to eat in there. I would not worry about things that you call kundalini overload. Most of that is just false information. And life force is a natural healing process. And you got to remember that when you start taking care of yourself, you might just start feeling weird because you're not used to living in that way. In the same way that when you go to a chiropractor or get a massage and you get everything worked out, but it's been all kind of kinked up and weird for 20 years. Well, then you're walking around and you think, well, this is strange. You know, if I feel crooked and I don't feel right, even though you're actually more stable than you were before. And the reason I don't want you to think about things like kundalini overload is because, again, most of the individuals I know who are talking about that and have a focus on that don't have a whole lot of insight. So when you have things that occur, like being dizzy or lightheaded or ungrounded, you just got to back off. You just got to back off. And you can blame it on something like kundalini overload, or it could just be that your body is working something out. That's usually what's occurring. When it comes to having shortness of breath and so on, again, that's because you're probably breathing weird. Or, for example, you might not know how to do diaphragmatic breathing. You probably breathe mainly up here in your chest, which means it looks like this. It's like, if you watch my chest, you know, when I'm breathing, if I'm breathing just in my chest and you see someone doing that, it's like this. That's an exaggeration, but it's like, it's pulling up. And when you pull up, well, then all these muscles pull down and that messes with your craniosacral system. And then you get dizzy and weird. And then it feels like you can't breathe because these things get tight and locked down. So most of the time, it's not a kundalini overload. It's because a person isn't hasn't learned yet how to do diaphragmatic breathing. So again, diaphragmatic breathing, Google that, look that up. Start practicing that first. And when it comes to breath exercises, just breathe normally and naturally. You won't get lightheaded or dizzy if you just breathe normally and naturally. You know, and really, just keep in mind that there's so much folklore and myth around all this kind of stuff that it is extremely, extremely simple, normal, and basic. Anything else? What was the quote that we had earlier? Open the cell door rather than decorate the prison, right? It's the same thing. And, you know, religions and spirituality are notorious for adding more things. You know, it's like, it's simple, but the mind needs more complexity. So we add something. All right. Well, first you got to just be present. And then you're present. That's not enough. So maybe you need to breathe in a different fashion. So let's just breathe differently. Okay. Now we got to focus on something internally. Man, we'll just focus on the heart. Okay. Well, that was good, but now we got to focus on all the chakras. Now we got to explore different states of consciousness. Now we got to look at different heavenly realms. Now we got to have different sounds with each chakra. It's all because of an extremely bored mind, really. And the simpler you keep it, the more obvious you treat it, the better off you're going to be in the long run. So stay out of the mind. Don't make it complicated. Okay, so this seems like, one more question. Okay, so that's not a question, just a statement. Yeah, definitely need to take it one day at a time. That's the best way to look at it. Because, again, if you get in the race mentality, that I need to be awake right now, well, that's no different than the person who's just trying to get into heaven or, you know, experience something other than what's actually there. So let's go ahead and get to the contemplative process. And why do I find this to be so valuable, so important? Because when you practice contemplative meditation, you're moving from the mechanical. Let's recite a mantra. Let's do 13,000 Kriya pranayamas, because it's going to be the 13,001 that's going to wake us up. You're moving from the mechanics to the actual reason why you're doing it. So I gave the example of being an athlete. And an athlete lifts weights and runs and trains, not so they can keep running and lifting weights and training, but so that they can play their sport. And for a yogi, what's the sport? The sport is to be intimately aware and participating in the web of the wholeness of life, to move from a little object that's at the mercy of all the other objects around it to a living, breathing presence that is now aware of everything around it as itself and can actually have conversations with it. It's like being in a real relationship, right? When you have people who are in relationship, like a good friend of mine spent a number of years in a bad relationship. It wasn't bad in the sense that it was abusive or that it was violent or anything like that. It was bad in that people hardly talked. You know, they were just two warm bodies in the same room. That's not a real relationship. That's two people just simply existing together. They're not conversing. They're not creating. They're not interacting with each other. So what most of us are doing throughout the day is we're just an isolated thing, and we feel alien to consciousness. That's why we make up stories to feel like we need to be one with things. And we feel that we're at the mercy of everything else around us. We're just like an unconscious rock. But when you start practicing yoga, you then are able to interact with consciousness. You are then able to have an intention. I would like to experience this. You contemplate it, you move in that direction. The rest of you provides the opportunities for you to experience that. You have an interaction. You say, look, I'd like to go here and explore this. The rest of you says, great, wonderful. So we're going to give you insights. You're going to respond to the insights. We're going to give you more insights. You're going to respond to them. Eventually, you'll have the experience. A yogi says, I want to know what it really means to be part of this infinite consciousness. And if the person can get quiet and clear inside and listen, then they can do their part and set the intention. I want to know this. And then they get quiet and clear so that they can be they go from the active part of the relationship to the passive, just like relationships do, active and passive, back and forth, to where now they can sit quietly and wait for that information to be revealed to them. And so when you start being able to practice contemplative meditation, you move from trying to put yourself in a trance to escape all the problems from the world to actively being able to explore your consciousness. You want to know something? You have that conversation with yourself. It might take a little while to work it out, but then you know it. And it moves even beyond that to even your daily life. This is where you have to be kind of cautious, because in your daily life, once you get clear, your wonderings or curiosity will actually start to manifest itself without you even really doing anything, because you are in that relationship. So that's why at this point, I'm very cautious about the things I wonder. Because there will be many situations where a thought will come into my mind of like, wow, how can that be? You know, how is that even possible? And I usually wonder that if it's something that seems to be not so good. And I've learned through the years that when I wonder that, usually I'm going to be able to experience something in the near future, which is going to say to me, this is how it happens. So I become extremely cautious of that now. In the same way that you can, as you participate in all of this, let's say you lose something. You lose something and you don't know where it is. And those of you who might have taken an astrology class with me have heard this story before. When it first dawned on me about how this worked, I had lost my wallet. I hardly ever lose my wallet. You know, when I leave, it's okay. Do I got my phone, my keys, and my wallet? When I come home, I put them somewhere. But I just couldn't find it. Days had gone by, and it's got my credit cards in there, some cash, my driver's license—very important things. And I was in this state of stress about not having it. So, according to the rest of me, the infinite, I was in that state of, I don't have it. And so therefore I couldn't find it. But then it occurred to me, I thought, well, this meditation and contemplation stuff works pretty well. So I decided to ask myself, what would it feel like if I knew exactly where it was? And what would it feel like if I had that moment of, oh, look, there it is. That feels great. So I changed that worry, that stress to, I know exactly where it is. It's going to come into my hands real soon. I mean, like, it's right there. Like, this feels so good to have it back in my hands again. I kid you not, within 5 minutes of changing in that way, I immediately remembered where I put it. And I found it. And that has been a constant occurrence, repeatedly. So the same thing, that if you're going through life feeling like you don't belong, you don't know what the infinite is, you have no idea what unconditional love is, well, that is your inner state resonating, and the rest of you is paying attention and saying, well, you don't know, so we're going to keep that up. That's your choice, whether you are conscious of it or not. So if you're able to say, no, I know exactly what it is. I know exactly what it means to experience myself as a part of everything, and you have conviction about it, and you do that in your meditation, you will know it. That's why I tried to describe to you earlier on that you need to start accepting that it is possible for you to understand what you want to understand, to get out of your head any kinds of guilt or negative thought processes that make you say you can't know something or you can't realize something. Because the more you have that deep down inside, the less likely you're going to experience it. So the purpose of our meditation techniques are to be able to calm us down first and foremost, to get us internalized. So that way we have the capacity to have this minute by minute, second by second, living, breathing communion with everything that we've always been. And particularly in meditation, you know, I asked you, why did you come to meditation? And you gave me a list of things. Well, you have to start contemplating whatever that reason was. What would it be like if I could feel that? And yeah, I know it's possible that I can feel that. And as you get quiet inside and you bring your awareness to the spiritual eye or crown and you ask, well, what am I? Or what is it, unconditional love? Or in this book, I give a whole list of possible things that I've explored personally, questions that you can use. Who am I? What is the point of this life? What is divine consciousness? Why is there suffering in this world? Why did I choose to live in this world that is a constant recurring cycle of pleasure and pain? Is God really what I think he or she is? What happens after we die? What was I before I was born? What does it mean to be spiritual? What am I afraid of when I have no real reason to be? What would it be like to live in the present moment? What is my mind? Is it real? Are we really one? What is true spiritual love? What am I? Is this experience real? These are all things that if you really wonder that, like if you really can't understand something, you have to take it into your meditation and ask. And you have to do it consistently, repeatedly, until the realization dawns. And you have to have, have the patience to be able to ask the question and the faith to trust yourself to present the answer to you, right? Because if you're asking the question and it doesn't come and you get frustrated and you quit, well, you're frustrated. That's what you're really saying to the universe. And so therefore, you're going to continue experiencing things that are frustrating. So it's a tricky, tricky, tricky thing because it takes such subtlety of awareness to do it well. But the only way that you get good at it is by practicing it and taking note of the results and responding to the results. And what I mean by responding to the results, I mean that if you're trying to figure out what is unconditional love, and you're meditating on that, and then it occurs to you that unconditional love is accepting the bully in your office, is making peace with the fact that, you know, certain countries are mean or whatever it might be. And that's really what the response is. And you don't take that to heart and start living from that knowledge. You, in a sense, are like saying to someone who has a lot of information, you know what? I didn't really care about that. And so now when you go to the person to ask the questions again, he's going to say, look, you didn't listen the last time I told you, so I'm not going to tell you anymore. And that's how most of us function. Is that we don't have intuitive insights, or we can't get knowledge immediately because it's available, accessible to all of us, because we go through the world ignoring the knowledge that's revealed to us. Why? Because we want to defend our limited sense of self, who we think we are, and we don't want to change to grow up into that individual who can have deep knowledge and insight. And this transcends into other areas of your life. You know, it's like when you go into a situation and you don't know what to do. Well, don't say, I don't know what to do. That might be true at the moment, but say, you know what? I know exactly what to do and it's going to work out right. I'm going to make the right choice. And if you can hold that quietude and wait for the inspiration to arise as what to do and you follow it, you're going to make the right decision. Sometimes it may even mean that the response is you do nothing. And if that's what arises, well, then you do nothing, right? So this is hard because we have an ego that wants to control situations and wants it to go a certain way. And what we're doing is we're reversing the process and not saying, what does the little I want? We're saying, okay, what's appropriate here? And then you trust and you act upon that. So I'm going to, you know, we're going to discuss how to bring this up into meditation. But Do you have any questions about this? Any thoughts or responses before we get into that specific procedure? It's a very easy procedure. But anything that came up for you through this discussion together that you need clarifying? And as I'm waiting for your response to that, someone wrote a comment, what was your face before your mother was born? That's not quite what I'm talking about, because that is a what you might call a koan, which is something that really doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And the point of it is, the point of a koan, like a Zen koan, isn't to give you insight into something specific. The point of a Zen koan is to have you think about something that makes absolutely no sense until eventually the mind breaks down and shuts off. So that's what a koan, like what is the sound of one hand clapping, right? That's a nonsensical thing. It's a good thing, and it's a very wonderful, like you can follow that, and there's nothing wrong with that, but this is different than the contemplative aspect. I'm talking about you getting actual knowledge from yourself. Okay, so wondering is somewhat like a prayer, a request, but asking oneself instead of God. I mean, I get what you're saying there, but if everything is one thing, if you're asking yourself, if you're asking God, is there really a difference? I mean, that's my interpretation of that. I don't look at it like I'm asking myself as in a little person. I'm asking the bigger you, which is God, obviously, right? That's the one thing that I would always get in a difficult state with the assistant minister at the meditation center. Is I would give these talks and I would say things like, well, if we listen to what the texts say, that everything is God, well, then that means everything is God. You can't go back on that. And so if everything is God, then that means you're God too. And why don't you just live from that? And the assistant minister would say, you can't tell people that. You can't go around telling them they're God. And I would say, why not? It's true. Maybe they need to hear it. But so it's like a prayer, sort of. You know, prayer is like a supplication and asking for something. But in my mind, that what I'm trying to describe is actually more like prayer, because it's not of a begging nature. It's more of an exploratory nature. Okay, so good question. Where was it here? So when we ask, what am I? And the immediate response is, I am God. Is that arrogance or just a statement without knowledge? It could be arrogance. There are plenty of people out there who just arrogantly, like when they think of the word God, they have an idea of what that means, and that's arrogance. But what I would say is, well, if there is, then this is a part of the process, so it's good that you bring this up. When you ask, what am I? And the response is, I am God. Well, the next follow-up should be, well, what is God? Right? So if you already know what God is, you wouldn't ask that question, because you would know that that is you anyway. But if the response is a word, like I am God, well, then you have to follow it further. And you might, and remember, it's like a conversation. So not all conversations are simply, you know, would you like some pudding? Yes. You know, they're not all that simple. It's more like, what would you like to eat? How would you like that cooked? Would you like anything else with it? Right. And so when it comes to, the contemplative process, it's similar. When you get a response, you then have to follow it up to make sure you have either a direct knowledge and understanding, or if there's a part of the response you don't understand, then you have to follow it again into the next thing. Like, you've heard me talk about this before, I'm sure, if you've listened to some of my videos, but one of my most enjoyable contemplations, you know, there's a... there's these statements that, like we said, that God is everything. But then there are other statements that say, you are not the doer. God is the doer. So if you stop and you think about that, well, if I am not the doer and only God is the doer, but yet God is everything, which means God is also me and you, what the hell? And that's what came up. I thought, that doesn't make any sense. So I decided to meditate upon that. And I took it into my meditation, and I just honestly asked. I said, all right, look, if the idea is God, you are everything, God is everything, and I'm not the doer, but God is everything, and God is the doer, and I'm God, so therefore, I'm also the doer, right? And I can't describe to you the response I had, because it was beyond words. But in that exploration for me, it became clear. The confusion was reconciled. And you'll find that, and you need to pay attention to things like that, where you're confused, where you read one thing here and you read another thing there, and you're like, well, that doesn't make any sense. They're being contradictory. And you might need to bring that into your meditation. Say, all right, what's really going on here? Until you have an insight. So don't hesitate to even, there's nothing heretical about asking questions. You know, you need to have the answers to them. Otherwise, you'll be wondering the rest of your life. Okay, so, you know, there's a comment about contemplating, well, what is happiness? And the person has a pretty good life and they're pretty happy. And what they realize is what they want is unconditional happiness, to be happy without attachment to the good, the bad, and the ugly. And so they now, from this point forward, you have to start contemplating, well, what really is unconditional happiness? What does that mean, unconditional happiness, to have that? And when you get the response, whatever that response is for you, then you have to start living from that knowledge. You see, if you don't start living from the knowledge, it doesn't matter whether you get the glimpse of insight or not. It's not going to, as you put it, bring you closer to God and your true self, because you're not actively engaging it. And again, that's why a lot of non-dualist teachers, you know, they have these once-in-a-lifetime awakening experiences, but they never explore it any further than that. So they build their whole career on one experience. And then they talk from that one experience, but they never use that as the jumping point into the big ocean to actually have a sense of what is that really true. So the same is true with your contemplative processes. You will have awakening experiences based on the things you're contemplating, but you can't just leave them alone. You have to start living from that knowledge in the same way that my contemplation, that everything is the doer, or excuse me, everything is God. But I'm not the doer. God is the doer, but God is everything. When I had that realization, it was great, but I didn't put it into practice. And then I got confused again. And I kept, I was like, well, I still don't quite get it. And then I did it three more times. And on the fourth time, I thought, great, now I get it. I have to start living from this bit of knowledge. And I did. And then that understanding stood with me, or stayed with me, stood with me, stood with me too. But, it stayed with me. So you got to remember that this process is not a one-dimensional process. This is a very subtle process, your spiritual growth. And it's not just limited to your meditation time. It permeates every aspect of your life. To treat it as though every aspect of your life is having this kind of consistent conversation, this living experience. Okay, so a few more comments. Yeah, good. So that wasn't a question, that was just a comment. So another question, can you apply this for making decisions in life? Most definitely you can. I mean, remember, we're not here just to like be blown around, we're here to participate. And just like if you had a wise, you know, person in your life or a counselor, do you sit around and you know they've got the answer? And you know that if you ask them what to do, they'll give you a good answer. And if you apply it, that you'll be successful. Do you say, well, you know, I don't want to cheat. You know, I don't want to take advantage of the wise elder over there. I'm just going to keep making mistakes. And that's what most of us do, because we're too proud. So this is, in a sense, giving up your pride. And if there's a decision you have to make, you can take this into your meditation and say, all right, look, you know, what is the best choice here? And you might want to start with, what do I need to understand about making this decision? Because you might inquire, what is the best choice? And you get an answer. But if you don't really understand what's all behind the reasoning there, then you might make the choice and something might go wrong. And then you're going to say, well, that didn't work. When really, as I mentioned earlier, we cannot know for sure whether something works out good or bad, whether that really is a good or bad thing, because there will be things that follow from it, right? There will be things that follow from it. So essentially, what does this take us to? It takes us to surrender and faith. That's what this is. That's what this whole thing takes you to. Eventually, it takes you to surrender and faith, trusting yourself. Okay, so after getting the response, we meditate. I saw light, felt love, sadness, joy, and then the statement, I am God, I am everything, is stated in the mind. If I got my answer, then why ask further? Because was that transformational for you? Like, it's transformational to know, when you say, I am God, to know what God is. To just know it doesn't really change the way you live your life, or it doesn't stop you from seeking. So you continue asking further until there's absolutely no more questions, right? That's the whole point of all this. You know, we get involved in usually meditation and spirituality because we have these questions, we have these doubts, and they plague us all our life. We don't just go through life knowing we are this infinite divine consciousness and just letting life flow through us and not worrying about whether things go wrong or not. What we do is we overthink things, we plan, we try to control situations. We have questions, we wonder, that's why we meditate. And when you have no more questions, then you are at peace. Right. So you can go beyond the mind in many different ways. You can go beyond the mind by going into a trance-like state. And if that works and your mind never comes back up again and bothers you, fine. But that's not the case for most people. You can go beyond the mind by exploring very deeply what you want to know until you get to the point of the direct realization that the mind can't answer that question. And then you have to jump over that abyss of accepting that. And once you can jump over the abyss, how do I get over the abyss? Then you're free, right? So you go until there are no more questions to be asked. Okay, so let's see if this is a question. It's a comment for sure. All right, so let's see, where did that question go? So there are absolute and relative levels to the question. That's exactly right. Who or what are you? At the relative level, there's still the person. Name, title, job, responsibilities, history, right? When we start talking about the absolute level, there's nothing else to talk about. Because at the absolute level, all is one and I am that I am. Exactly. And again, what the sage or the saint can do is exist on both levels with knowledge, right? The problem is most people want to escape into the absolute level and ignore the relative level as though it is something separate and not a part of the infinite. And so the reason we question these things is because we need to be able to exist relatively speaking as well as absolutely speaking and be at peace with that. And once you do that, then you are free. Otherwise, you're trying to escape into the absolute, where you're just blinded by the relative. And both times, you're in delusion there. So that's why you have to have the fullness of the experience, the relative and the absolute. And then another question comes up. What do you surrender to? That's a good question. So do you know what I would say in response to that question? What do you surrender? You asked me the question, what do you surrender to? What would I tell you to do based on everything we've been talking about? Contemplate on it. Exactly. Because it doesn't matter. And this is again, the issue that I take with spiritual teachers is most of them who are out there on the circuit are just talking and talking and talking and sharing ideas and thoughts and more imagery, but you can't talk someone into understanding. You can say, you ask the question, what do you surrender to? And I can contemplate that and I have an understanding. Okay, this is what I'm surrendering to. And it's a direct experience. But I can't take that experience and push it on you, and you go, oh, look, there it is. You can sometimes, when you're meditating with others who have direct experience, catch a glimpse of it, but you yourself have to work it out. So when you ask the question, what do you surrender to? Well, the first thing I would say is you need to figure out what you mean by surrender. So I would focus on, what does it mean to surrender? I would focus on that first. And then I would say, okay, well, if surrender is important based on what I understand it to mean, then I would ask, well, what do I surrender to? And I would wonder about that until the realization dawned. And it's not going to be anything I could tell you. Once you have it, you couldn't tell me, you couldn't tell Stephanie, or you couldn't tell Dinesh. You would have the experience. So you see, this is why also this is a deeply personal path. And why you can meet someone and you can talk to someone and you can have absolutely no idea that they are a clear, awake individual. Because people are good at playing the parts and other people don't care to play the part, because it's not about playing a part. It's about learning to be able to have that kind of connection, and or not have the connection, but realize the connection and understand the power and intimacy of the whole process. So again, you need to start looking at these things like relationships. And do you want a relationship to be alive? And do you want a relationship to be the exploration together? Or do you want to be like my friend who was just, you know, like, here I am existing in this world, and I know God's out there, and I'm in here, and we're in the same room, but I'm not going to talk to you. And I'm not going to listen when he talks to me. Do you want that? Or do you want to say, ah, there you are. Here I am. Oh, look at this. We're one whole thing. We're both the doer. How does that work? Oh, I see. This is lovely. You know, that kind of a thing. And that's why, that's when people can sit in meditation for hours, because it's a joy. They're exploring their consciousness. It's not a task. Now, there's one other thing. So the question arrives, what is nirvikalpa samadhi? Is it like you do not have any questions left after that? Well, again, my question to you would be, what is your current understanding of nirvikalpa samadhi? When you hear that word, what does it mean to you? So I'm going to ask you that. When you hear the word nirvikalpa samadhi, based on what you've studied, what you've heard other people say, the way it's been described to you, what is it? Yeah, and while I'm waiting for Dinesh to respond, Deborah's point is very good. She says she's not sure about the surrendering part. Well, that's exactly right. That's why we do the contemplation, because we're not sure. And we do it so that we can be sure. Because if I spent 3 hours talking to you about surrender, at the end of the day, would you really know what surrender is? Well, you'd have a lot of words. You could tell other people what I said. You could think to yourself, well, I don't experience that, so I must not be surrendered. But you won't know until you ask, right? And you're going to spend some time on it. There are many, many points of contemplation that I've spent a good number of years on. So I want you to, and it wasn't just that I spent the number of years on one line of questioning. It was, I asked a question, I got a response. It led me a little deeper. And there's some that they cleared up in a matter of days, or even one whole session. I remember going into contemplation. The answer just came, and that was it. I lived from it. So it's going to be different, only because there are different things you might have to go to finally get the real answer. And Dinesh says, I felt a lot of joy and peace in the company of some monks. What is that? Well, it could be that they are clear, and that is their state. And when you get in that state, you're just aware of it. It could be you have an expectation, and since you have that expectation, it happens. I know plenty of people, when I've gone to various different talks and whatnot, and I watch individuals and how they respond to certain teachers, and I'm listening to what the teacher says, and having been in the circuit for a while, I've actually met and talked to the teachers, and I know what they say behind the scenes. And how they act behind the scenes. And I'm not talking about, you know, just being a normal human being. I mean, just sort of some weird things that go on in their head. And you watch people who meet them and they just act like they've just met, you know, the next incarnation of Ramana Maharshi or something. And it's because they have that expectation based on hype and what other people have said. I'm not saying that's the case for you, Dinesh, but that is a distinct possibility. And that happens more than you can probably imagine. Also, there's the collective group consciousness of having an expectation of an experience that comes into play. But when it's not that, when you just happen to be around someone and all of a sudden you feel a peacefulness come over you, the way it works is, imagine when you've been around someone who is sad or who is angry, you start to feel a little agitated. So it just shows that we as humans have a tendency to kind of resonate together, and that if you're able to appreciate the quiet of someone else, and you naturally have that capacity too, you'll feel it and you'll experience it. You know, I remember meeting one really fantastic teacher. I mean, he just blew my mind, and it was just radically, it's kind of like what you were experiencing, I think, Dinesh. And afterwards, some people, I heard them talking at the lunch, they were saying, oh, that person has such a dark cloud around them. You know, they're so caught up in their ego. And I just had to chuckle. I'm thinking, what on earth are you talking about? I didn't say it. But when I listened to the rest of their conversation, you could tell that they were picking up on their own projections of what was going on inside them. So you got to be real careful about projecting onto others. But there are situations where you're just in another person's presence, and because they're calmer, you naturally get calmer. And that's why, as you wrote, it was lost after some time. Because again, if you're around someone who's anxious and angry, you might feel that way while you're around them, and it might take you a little while to shake that off. So the same thing about experiencing a state of clarity around certain people. You feel it, but you need to use that not to say, I need to be around you all the time. You need to say, I'm recognizing an aspect of myself in this quiet, and now I need to accept that it's also within me. That's, you always got to take it back to that. If you don't, you're in a definite trap. But again, I'm not intuiting that that is true for you, Dinesh. I'm just explaining based on many diverse experiences I've had. All right, so one other comment. Okay, so that's not a question, so that's good. Yeah, so that is why meditation is said to be private and contained. No need to tell anyone about it or join a group. No one needs to know that you brushed your teeth. That's exactly right. And really, what you're figuring out with all of this is that you are not separate from the things you think you're separate from. That you do have the capacity to gain knowledge directly. But that does require that you are mature enough to handle that knowledge. And you know that you're mature enough to handle that knowledge when you ask a question and the response is revealed to you. And then you live from that knowledge from that point forward. And it's, again, it's a self-limiting factor. I mean, if you don't respond to the knowledge, it just indicates that you're not mature enough. And so you won't be really, you won't feel as tapped into it normally. And by taking more responsibility also develops more faith and more capacity for surrender. And when you have faith and surrender, if you haven't gone through a lot of the internal processes of meditation, it is most definitely going to feel restricting and like you are being discouraged. But that's only because when you're a kid and you want to eat an ice cream sundae before dinner, well, your parent, hopefully, is going to say, don't eat that ice cream sundae so that you can eat your dinner. And as a kid, you're going to throw a fit. Because you want that ice cream sundae and you want it now, right? And that's the way we act, spiritually speaking, often. We want that bright, radiant experience right now. We don't want to do the work to prepare us for it so that we can actually understand it, right? The same thing with desserts. They have their appropriate place, but it's not before dinner. And by learning how to practice contemplation, you then learn that you are not in an alien world where you're cut off from the good things in life. You start to realize you are in a living, breathing, magnificent, infinite space. That's the most I can say about it right now. But once you start to see that, that becomes refreshing and enjoyable. And then you want to meditate, and then you want to practice contemplation, because it's like you just met your best friend, right? And it happens to be you. So, and you don't have to go anywhere to meet this person, right? That's why, you know, a lot of these texts, they talk about the divine is the beloved, right? That's where this comes from. And you read the text and you make these fantasies about it actually is like meeting the beloved. And it's not really. That's just the way they were able to interpret it so that you could get a sense of it. But that is kind of close, you know, but they are just words to lead you to the understanding. All right, so let's go ahead and do a meditation together, focusing on contemplation. One last thing I want to say, because I don't feel I can say it enough. You meditate with a technique to train yourself to calm down, to sit still, to ignore all the distractions, or to resolve them and give them up to this radiance of the self, which is also just a metaphor, but it's a very good one that works in this situation. Once you are calm as possible, that doesn't have to be perfect. You don't have to have a completely silent mind. You just have to be able to focus on what you want to know. And you get done with your meditation techniques and you're calmer, more internalized. And then you just ask your question. And how do you ask your question? You ask the question with sincerity and curiosity, not out of fear, like, I need to know this, but out of, no, really, like, what is this all about? You know, and you need to let go of any fear of being, of asking the wrong question, because especially in this, there are no wrong questions. If you are sincere about what you want to know, yourself is not going to say, you're just being a little shit, so therefore I'm not going to answer you, you know, because some parents do that, right? If a kid asks a question, they act like they're just being difficult, and that's not the way it works. Now, if the question is just silly, well, they might ignore the question, but it's rarely, rarely silly. Especially if there is deep insights that are required to come to you. So you ask the question by contemplating. And let's just do a little bit now, and then we'll go into the meditation. So I'll give you some insights into how I would approach this particular process. So let's say we really want to know, what am I? And we know in our mind that there is an absolute self, which is part of everything. We know that mentally. We know there is a relative self, which is, you know, for me sitting here, the sun's gone down, I'm at my desk, got my nice warm robe on. I have a relationship with many different people. I feel this way about certain things. I have a sense of self. So I know that there is an absolute and a relative. But I want to know what does that all mean? What am I? And so what we'll do is just sit there like you are. Don't close your eyes. Don't take in any kind of special meditation posture. If you're just hanging out, just hang out. But I want to encourage you to, at this point, just be aware of what your experience is right now. What are you experiencing? Don't label it. Just notice it. What do you see? What do you hear? What do you feel? What are you experiencing? Okay. And I'll just wonder for a moment. Well, what am I that is experiencing this? You know, what is experiencing this? Wonder that, you know. I see these things, I experience this. But what is the experiencer? Ask that in your mind. And you can do this later in meditation. And so if you just wonder about this, you just hear me talking, you're sitting there and you're experiencing, but you want to know what is experiencing this. And then immediately it pops up, well, I am experiencing this. Okay. So you went from one stage to another. Okay. Well, I am. well then, I, all right, what is that? I am, but what is this I? So now you're focusing on I. And you have another response come in, a very obvious one. Well, I am this body. I am this mind. I am these likes and these dislikes. Okay, well, that's I. So this body, this mind, these thoughts they're experiencing, well, no, that can't be true because I am aware of this body and I am aware of these thoughts. So if I am aware of something else, that something else isn't really me. All right, so we're back at square one again. Well, then you ask, well, was I existing last night while I slept? And you wonder that. Well, sure I was, because I'm here now, and I couldn't have not existed and then existed again. Was I aware of the dreams I had? Okay, yes. And I wasn't aware of the body at the time. I wasn't aware of the mind at the time. So obviously, this I exists here now, being aware of the body as well as in dreams. So the I, that's something. And then you take it a little deeper. Well, what is this I? And then you start having the sense that, okay, the I is this little point in the back of my head, which is aware of all of the senses. It's aware of what's coming in from my eyeballs. It's aware of what I hear. It's aware of what I taste. It's in my head somewhere. And it's also aware of my thoughts. So then you move into the realization, oh, I am the observer. I am the seer. Good, we're making progress. So I am the seer. Well, what is the seer, right? What is the seer? Okay, what is the seer? And you contemplate this. And when you ask, what is the seer? You just ask, what is the seer? And then you be quiet for a little bit. Well, the seer is what sees. And you, well, what sees? And this keeps going on, and you keep kind of bouncing around in this space, and you're getting a little more subtle, a little more internalized. And then you think to yourself, well, surely the seer is the thinker. That's got to be it, right? The seer is the thinker. But then you hold your mental breath. And you're not thinking, but you still exist. So therefore, the seer is not the thinker. But the seer still exists, even without thinking. So then you're inspired, you're inclined to simply exist as the seer. And you hold that, just observing, being the seer, as long as you can, until eventually you're always the seer, and you always are the seer anyway, but you are consciously aware of the fact that you are the seer. And then you get your answer. You know what you are. You are the I. You know what the I is. You've kind of broken it down. You realize that the seer is the I, the seer is beyond the mind, and that you can exist beyond the mind. So that might lead you to another contemplation. And what might that contemplation be? How is it possible that the seer exists beyond the mind? And that's going to take us to a point where, again, we cannot discuss. So I use this example because there are aspects of the example which do show up as like a thought response. But most all of your contemplations may start that way as you figure out what you mean by the terms. But they're always going to lead you to a direct knowing that you cannot discuss. It's just, I wish I could describe it, but I can't. And you'll understand the more you go through this process. And then when we meet, you know, I'll say, so how's your contemplation going? You're like, you know what? I get it. And I'll say, tell me about it. You say, you know, I can't. And I know, I will know then exactly, I will know what you are talking about because I know what you mean by you saying, you know, I can't. In the same way that, you know, someone says, man, have you had a Fuji apple? Like, yeah, I've had a Fuji apple. And you don't have to describe the flavors. You don't have to describe the texture. Or you just, you know the person's had a Fuji apple by the look on their face, right? So this is how contemplation works. Does this make sense? Do you follow what I'm trying to share here? Okay, good. Yes, it sounds like a lot of work. It is a lot of work. But it's fun. Okay, so let's go ahead and let's just practice some very basic stuff together, basic contemplation together, and realize that you may have an experience during this session that reveals the process. You get the answer. You may not. You might have to come back to it and review the process until it becomes natural to you, in the same way that, just like anything else, you keep practicing until you get it. So let's take a moment to bring our attention to our bodies. To our current state of consciousness, whatever that may be for you. How do you feel? What is your experience? And so on. What is going on around you? What do you notice? Breathe. Now close your eyes. Pull your attention internally within. Whatever that means to you to pull your attention within, do that now. And put your awareness on your heart. Just on your heart, center of your chest, in between your shoulder blades, that center of your chest. And on the inhale, mentally chant, so. On the exhale, mentally chant, hum. And with each repetition, allow yourself to pull away from distractions, to internalize your awareness. Resting your attention on the mantra, so hum. Remember any distractions arise, you allow to be channeled up through into the radiance above you, and so that you are able to dissolve the distractions, let them go. And you sink your attention more fully into the mantra Soham, staying upright and alert, holding your attention on the heart chakra, letting the feeling within the heart chakra grow stronger with each repetition of the mantra. Now let go of the mantra and lift your awareness, lift your attention up into the spiritual eye center gently. You're not straining. You're just aware of that part of your body, the space between the eyebrows. Letting the breath be natural and maybe slightly deeper than normal, but not enough to strain. And establish yourself in the spiritual eye center. Just hold your awareness there. And now, again, ask the question, wonder, what is my relationship to the wholeness of life? And just ask it once with feeling, with meaning, what is my relationship with the wholeness of life? Keeping your attention directed at the space between the eyebrows. And then just sit patiently waiting as though you're waiting for an answer to come. You're waiting for someone else to think about it. And they're pondering it over, wondering how best to share it with you. What is my relationship with the wholeness of life? And then ask again, with feeling, what is my relationship with the wholeness of life? And then consider, what do I really think the wholeness of life is? What do I mean by that when I ask that question? What is the wholeness of life? And when you ask this question, you might have thoughts that arise that say, oh, this is the wholeness of life. This is what that means. And that's okay. Just pay attention. Ask the question, what is the wholeness of life? And then ask the question once more, what is my relationship with the wholeness of life? Keeping your attention on the spiritual eye center. Now, when you consider the question, what is my relationship with the wholeness of life? You also have to wonder, what do you mean by my? That's relating to I, a sense of individuality. So now wonder, what is this I that wants to know how it relates to the wholeness of life? What is this I? Is this I separate from the wholeness of life? Ask this with curiosity and an intention. What am I that wants to know about this wholeness of life? And then drop the question just for a moment and just breathe, focusing on the spiritual eye center, just letting go of all intention, of all wondering. Just breathe for a moment or two, holding the attention at the spiritual eye. Now, everything that you wondered, all the ideas that came into your mind about what you are, about what it means to be, knowing your relationship with the wholeness of life, bring up all that imagery, all those ideas, all the thoughts you had, all the imaginations you have, and now ask the question, once that's in your mind, what would it be like to experience that directly? What would it be like to have direct experience of this beyond my mental concepts that came to me? What would it be like to have direct experience of my relationship to the wholeness of life? Wonder and contemplate that for the next minute or two. Now drop that wondering. Let your awareness take up your heart space again, the fourth chakra in the center of your chest. Let go of all wondering, all contemplation, and just return to the mantra. So on the inhale, hum on the exhale. So you've done your contemplation. You've set your intention of what you want to know. Maybe you got a response, maybe you didn't. But now you let it go. You let it do its thing. You've planted the seed. So you finish the meditation, the practice, by returning to a technique to further center you internally. So feel the heart space and continue to chant so on the inhale, hum on the exhale. And this will take us to the end of our meditation time. And release the mantra. Let your attention permeate the rest of your body, your normal individualized sense of self. Take a few gentle, easy breaths. On the exhale, relax. And when you're ready, you can open your eyes. And this is how contemplative processes work. It's as simple as that. Usually you want to take some time to get into a clear, calm state as possible. Once you get there, then you have your chosen focus of contemplation. I do advise that you figure that out before you get started. You go through the process, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, whatever you can do comfortably without getting bored. And then to conclude, you could go back into another meditation technique just to kind of seal it up. And maybe you get the response during the contemplation. That happens very often. Maybe you're going to get it tomorrow morning when you're frying an egg. You know, maybe you're going to get it 3 days from now when you're on a hike on your favorite trail. But you got to remember that this is all part of one whole timeline. So just because you're not actively contemplating meditation doesn't mean the process doesn't continue and you don't get the realization later. You know, particularly with exploring the Yoga Sutras, Vasistha's Yoga, the Bhagavad Gita, even when I was in college and I was trying to figure out physics equations, you know, those ideas would come to me later, you know, when I wasn't doing contemplation or when I was trying to study astrology. Maybe some things would come, but usually it's when I'm in the shower. All of a sudden, it's just overwhelming, the realization that occurs based on what I've been contemplating. So it's not just, it doesn't stop because you stop asking the question. In the same way that, you know, when you're having a conversation, maybe you ask someone something, they say, let me get back to you. And then they finally call you up out of the blue and say, remember what you were asking about? And then they tell you. So it can be very similar to that. So we'll go ahead and we'll conclude for this evening. Or morning, wherever you happen to be. If you want to go ahead and do some longer meditation on your own, you know, another 20 to 30 minutes, I would advise that, just to let all this sink in, explore it. Otherwise, don't worry about it, but bring your questions tomorrow, about 12 hours from now, or I guess that would be 13 hours from now. We will meditate again twice more tomorrow, and we will have specific focus on your questions, whatever they may be, dealing with this weekend's instruction or other things you've heard that you need me to debunk, or just things you want to get more clear on. So we'll be in touch soon.